We're continuing in the Gospel of John. This will be our 54th exposition of this wonderful gospel. It's rather unique. John's gospel is unique and different from the other gospels in its focus. And I'm interested in it because this is the disciple whom Jesus loved, you know, that wrote this. We're told about Jesus' ministry, which was a very aggressive ministry. Indications are that John's ministry was this way too. They are both very aggressive ministries. That he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Now, in Jesus' ministry, we're introduced to the manner of divine life, how it is. It's active. It never reverts to useless idleness, not the work of God. God is never introduced this way. Jesus is never introduced this way. Apostolic messengers are never introduced this way. Servants of God are never introduced this way. They're not like idle people sitting about. This just is not the way divine life is. It's productive. It's never neutral. It's purposeful, always advancing to an appointed destination. There's always a reason for what God does. There's a reason for what his servants do. They're just not marking time or filling a slot or something of this sort. And Jesus, of course, he maintained constant communication with his Father. That was his secret. There was always a purpose served by what Jesus did, always a reason for it, a reason that was originated in heaven. And his stance in life, you want to pick up on this because this is what's been, we're partakers of Christ's life. Yeah. These things are in measure found in those that follow Jesus. Amen. He was always sensitive to God's will. He was always alert, knew what was going on. One of the signs of backsliding is people are losing awareness of what's happening, what God is actually doing. And the will of God with Jesus preeminently and also with us is always doing the will of God from the heart. If people aren't there, what they do doesn't even count on the divine scale. It's just ignored by heaven, so far as profitability is concerned. To have, be profitable, you've got to have the same focus Jesus did. Now, Jesus' work was different from ours, but his focus was the focus of the kingdom. It's the focus of what anyone with Jesus, this has got to be their focus. If their focus is this world, they're not in the ranks. Their work is useless. It will not be recognized by heaven. It will not, no matter what it is. It will not. And all of this, we shouldn't have to say this, but all of this is proportionate to our position in the body of Christ and our capacities. It's all measured by that. We can't duplicate Jesus as individuals, but we can have the same type of life and focus that he had. And we learn also from Jesus, he didn't learn what he did in the rabbinical schools. That's not where he got his learning, so to speak. Now, there are books in heaven, the scriptures tell us, and at the appointed time, these books, which are all of the deeds people have done, all the words they said, these books are going to be opened. Yeah. Nobody's going to be judged by grace. Everybody understands this, I trust. Yes, amen. Nowhere is judgment ever said to be by grace. Nowhere. It's always according to their works. Yeah, There are no exceptions to this, none at all. Judge every man according to his works. There's no exception to this. And these books, that's the record of the works, are all going to be opened. And before an assembled universe, it'll be proved that his people did his works.
Amen. Yeah, now his grace is allowing us to work out our salvation to where our works will be in compliance with grace, but it still be judged according to what you did or what you didn't do.
Yeah, you live by grace. Make no mistake about this. But with judgment, when you lose your body, you lose your need for grace as we know it. Grace compensates for the debility of that sin has caused. Anyway, that's an important thing to know. It may sound strange, but we're not ashamed to say you just find in Word of God if judgment is ever not according to works. If it's any place, from Genesis to Revelation, if you can find one place where people are going to be judged not judged according to works, well, you by all means post it.
Yeah.
I can tell you there isn't no such thing as that. So that being the case, I'm very interested in Jesus working. I'm very interested in that because he set the tone for how the work of God is to be done. Now, our text tonight is in John, the 4th chapter, verses 46 through 48. Jesus has left Samaria and gone to Galilee. So Jesus came again to Cana of Galilee, where he made the water wine. And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. And when he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. And Jesus said unto him, except ye see signs and wonders, ye will not believe. Well, that's what it says.
Right.
We'll be introduced to Jesus and try to make some sense out of all this. Now, Jesus completed the work that he was going to do in Samaria. That's why he left. Jesus didn't leave any place until what he was intending to do was done there.
Yeah.
So he left Samaria. He reaped a harvest there. The harvest was ready in a remarkably short period of time. Then 2 days, seed was sown, harvest was reaped in 2 days. How's that? But when it was finished, he moved on. He wasn't done with Samaria, but for that time, his ministry for Samaria was finished. And the reason this ministry was so successful, the testimony of the woman being blessed and the presence and words of Jesus being blessed, is because the power of God was present. That's what made these things successful. It wasn't a methodology or particular words. It was the power of God was present. That's what made this what it was. Now, just as on the day of Pentecost, it was successful because the power of God was present. When the whole city of Samaria believed at the preaching of Philip, that's because the power of God was present.
Yeah.
When all Ephesus was turned upside down by the preaching of Paul, it's because the power of God was present. See, that's the answer for the success that you read about in the book of Acts. It's the power of God was present, which means the people were saying and doing things that God could work. See, if the power of God's not present, it can only be because of one of two reasons. One is that God's not doing the work, not doing what they are doing. It's not in his agenda. Or the other is they're not using something that God can use. They're not employing means that God uses. That's the only reason why power be absent. Now, the people of God, and this will take some discipline, believe me when I tell you this. The people of God must not grow accustomed to religion without power.
Yeah, amen.
Now, you'll be tempted before the week is done you'll be tempted to be very, very charitable towards someone that has religion without power. But you can't acclimate to it. There's no such thing as a valid religion without power. There's no such thing as a messenger of God without power. Work of God without power. There is no such thing. But see, institutionalism allows people to operate outside the perimeter of divine power. In fact, that's the only way you can build an institution. Because God is not in the business of building an institution. He's commissioned his son to build a church, and everything else is going to fall.
Yeah, amen.
And you never want to be engaged in something that's going to fall. Now he comes to Cana of Galilee. This city is mentioned only four times in the Bible. And the four times are about three different occasions. This is where he done his first miracle, where he turned the water into wine, was Cana of Galilee. Second is the one our text states. And third is mentioned as the town where Nathanael lived. And it apparently was not a famous town, but to us that know the Lord, it's a very well-known town. Cana of the first miracle, and then the second miracle was worked there too. Now he makes a point of saying, it's where he made the water wine. And that's the place where he made the water, where he made. Not where we had 5,000. It's where he made the water wine. See, it's not where we raised so much money. It's where he made.
Yeah.
I'm saying this because people are taught to glory in wrong things.
Yeah.
It's where we had a very successful day out in the community. It's where he made the water wine.
Yeah. Amen.
I know you probably know this, but the psalmist said, Psalm 111:4, he hath made his wonderful works to be remembered. Oh, see, that's an important thing to remember. He has made them to be remembered. So when God works, it's not only to fulfill a certain objective then and there. It's so that men will remember.
Amen.
It's important to remember what God has done.
Yeah.
And he's done a lot.
Amen.
That's recorded. So there's a lot there to remember. He made his works to be remembered. Are you beginning in the book of Genesis, you've got all kind of records of his works. All the way up through Malachi, all of them were made to be remembered. I love that. When the day Israel was delivered from Egypt, on the very day they were delivered from Egypt, Exodus 13:3, Moses said, remember this day. Oh, don't forget this. And when they 40 years later on the border of the promised land, before Moses dies by the hand of God and is buried by him, he told the people, remember that thou wast a servant in Egypt and that the Lord thy God brought thee thence through a mighty hand. 40 years later. Remember this. Don't forget this. Again, he said, remember that thou wast a servant in Egypt and that the Lord thy God through thee brought thee thence through a mighty hand. Remember that. Later, Israel was admonished, remember his marvelous works which he hath done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. How about that? The judgments of his mouth. Remember. Don't forget that. You might be surprised how many professing Christians know very little about what God has said and done.
Yeah, amen. Yes.
Yeah, you might be, maybe you won't be, but you might be surprised if you would do a little bit of investigative work. You'll find that what he's done has been largely forgotten.
Yeah.
But he made his works to be remembered. Not forgotten. Several men in the Bible said, I remembered. I remembered. David said, and Jonah said it too. The disciples frequently are cited as remembering what Jesus said or did. They remember it. Amen. What he said or did. Now, if God made his works to be remembered, that serves to redefine the word, somewhat ambiguous word, relevant. Uh-huh. Hmm. That changes now how I look at that word. Anything God ever did from creation to this day is relevant.
Amen.
God never did do anything irrelevant. Now, as I've mentioned this before, that you might find it interesting to inquire from people what they know about Jesus. You might want to write it down someplace so you can peruse it later. And most of the time, you'll be astounded at how little people actually know about Jesus. It'll astound you. They'll say, "Oh, I love him with all my heart," but they don't know anything about him, hardly anything about him. You really love people you don't know much about? But this kind of mentality exists among people. Yes.
Through this study, I've been thinking about how the Lord is merciful to teach us how to think.
Yeah.
This is another way that he's doing that, is that he's revealing himself and the work of God.
That's right.
These things are teaching us how to think.
That's right.
How to think about God and how
that's
to think
right.
about his son and the things that what he makes known, he's showing us what is relevant.
That's
yes.
right.
Because what he is making known is what we give our attention to.
Amen.
Amen.
You might
Amen.
Say that your fellowship with God and with Christ centers around this knowing how to think. Yeah. Now, in this area, there was a certain nobleman there. Several people that contacted Jesus are unnamed. You probably know this already. They're like the woman at the well. She was unnamed. We read a certain nobleman of royal mm-hmm. occupation. Or we also read of a certain scribe mm-hmm. or a certain ruler or a certain man or a certain woman or a certain poor widow, a certain young man, a certain maid, mm-hmm. a certain Pharisee, a certain blind man, a certain lawyer. See, a group. One person.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. One person
yeah.
singled out of a group.
That's right.
And you see how rather common mm-hmm. that is. Groups of people like rulers, scribes, men, women, poor widows, young men, centurions, lawyers, Pharisees, blind men, maidens. Those are groups. Mm-hmm. Groups. But just one person singled out. Of the group. See, you must never allow yourself to be identified by a group.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's not our identity.
Uh-huh.
Not even Word of Truth Fellowship.
That's right. Amen.
This is not the thing that identifies us.
Amen.
Not the group.
Yeah.
The thing that identifies you is what God thinks of you.
Yeah. Amen.
And time you spend with God. That's what identifies you. That's what identified men like Enoch, who was like a loner if there ever was one. There'll be times in life you'll experience when the group won't be much advantage to you. Now, this certain nobleman, his son was sick in Capernaum. Notice in the presence of Jesus that earthly rank is of no consequence.
Yeah.
And she said, there's a person of royalty here. See, just,
uh-huh.
just a certain nobleman mm-hmm. with a royalty or a peasantry. Now, you want to catch this. I thought this was a pretty uh-huh. wise perspective. Mm-hmm. Genuine need strips you of any other distinction.
Yes.
Huh? That's the kind of an original thought to me it is. Anyway, genuine need strips you of distinction.
Yeah.
It's something that your distinction can't address this need or anybody else in that rank. Now, really, you got to get to that point before you really will experience the blessing of the Lord. You got to get to that point. Need humbles a person. See, the very fact that you have need, that's humbling. See, because that means you've got something you can't do anything about it.
Yeah.
See, that humbles you, shows your need.
You walk into a room, sometimes you can. Some of the women will be very beautiful, and others will be. But see, like in a cancer room filled with cancer patients, they're all bald. So it's what it does. When you can see people for who, what God's doing in them, that's when you've really been able to touch the person, the real person.
Real need means there's nothing in the world or anyone in the world that can help.
Uh-huh.
That's what that means. So need, if you see things correctly, need, if you don't see it right, is a robber. It'll take from your confidence you had before.
Yeah.
It'll take from your hope you had before it. See, if you see it right, need will do that. There are people who are condemned, will be condemned, damned, because they didn't see that they had an opportunity to minister to Jesus himself through his people. And they're going to be cast into outer darkness because of that.
Yeah. Amen. Yes.
It's Matthew 25.
Uh-huh.
Hmm? You did it not. When did we see you this? You did it not.
Yeah.
Under one of the least of these my brethren. See, that's how important it is to be alert. Some people have entertained angels unawares. They didn't know it. They thought they were entertaining people. Abraham did when the three visited him. Lot did when the two men visited him. They both entertained angels. They didn't realize they were angels. But see, they had the correct response, so it's credited to them.
Yes.
Now, the town of Capernaum, as I understand it, about 16 miles from Cana. So this was, for some people, that would be inconvenient. They didn't have, you know, automobiles and so forth. So that would have been inconvenient. But this need makes you look at difficulties different.
Yeah.
When you have real need, you're not thinking in terms of how far is it.
Uh-huh.
You know, I mean, this isn't the way you think at all. Now, he says his son was sick. Whose son was sick. Sick doesn't mean he didn't feel well.
Yeah,
see? I mean, we might say so-and-so was sick, they had a fever of 99. Well, that doesn't rank in Scripture as sick.
Right.
I mean, I understand about feeling bad and all this. If anyone does, I understand about that. But that's not what sick means in the Scriptures. Sick means, the word itself means weak, feeble, without strength, powerless, incapable of any kind. It's speaking of debility and incapacitation.
Uh-huh.
He couldn't do anything.
Yeah.
He was incapacitated. As a matter of fact, the text is going to tell us that he was right at death's door.
Yeah.
That's how serious this was. There are some infirmities that the apostle would say, take a little wine for your stomach's sake and you're off to infirmity. See, there's some things that can be addressed.
Uh-huh.
Go home and take an aspirin. There's some things that can be addressed that way.
Right.
But there are some things that can't.
Mm-hmm.
And blessed is the person that doesn't keep trying to find an earthly remedy, like that woman who was that woman with the issue of blood. She spent all her living on physicians and wasn't any better, see? So when you find something doesn't work, you try something else. It's just the way it is, how you should live. Don't keep doing profitless things over and over. So he heard of Jesus. He heard of Jesus. He heard. Yeah, I want to emphasize this, the alertness of this nobleman. He heard about Jesus. Now, he was probably surrounded by servants, so he didn't have to be alert to things. His servants could do this and do that, see? But this is something now that we don't rely on servants. He heard. He. It could be one of his servants told him, but somehow he heard. He was alert. And he's able to connect what he heard with his need. Right? He immediately, as he hears of Jesus, he associates that with something that's needed in his house. And why he heard Jesus is close enough to get to him quickly. That's why you want to develop an alert spirit.
Amen.
This does not, in our age, this does not come easily. Because there are thousands and thousands of things calling for your attention, and they're all unrelated to each other. So you kind of become scatterbrained. And this is where the world is. If they present something, it's always from a multifaceted viewpoint that if they make a point, it's just a little bitty point. See? So you're in that kind of world. But you want to learn to properly focus and be able to pick up on meaningful things that are happening in your vicinity. Something of consequence that's happening near you. Now this will come, of course, as a result of meditating on the Lord and walking with the Lord. It'll sharpen your sensitivities. You've been called into the fellowship of God's dear Son, 1 Corinthians 1:9 says. And we have the privilege of walking in the Spirit, Galatians 5:16 says. But these walks sensitize your spirit and your mind so that you pick up on things that need to be picked up on. And you're able to avoid things that are to be avoided. See, you've got to have a sensitive spirit. Which of us has not experienced getting distracted and something? You say, well, this has been a waste of time, you know. But there you were, down a wrong road, but you didn't recognize it at first. Also, this also teaches us, you know, David said, I will meditate of all thy work, and I will talk of thy doings.
Yeah.
What?
Amen.
What?
Yeah.
I will talk of thy doings. I like the sound of it. Well, that's how I came to be illuminated. Someone was talking about his doings.
Yes, amen.
He was apparently keeping track of Jesus, and he could pick up on this. This also highlights, you see, the value of testimony. Declaring what the Lord has done. David once said, I will meditate of all thy works and talk of his doings. I will do that. Now, the value of doing this must be accented. If God is working among us, if this is a proper evaluation, talk about it.
Amen.
There may be someone that hears you that's looking for what you've experienced.
Yeah.
They may not know anyone else has even had the need. So what God is doing, talk about it. So what about people who want to hear about it? Talk about it anyway.
Yeah.
Talk about it. Your words can be the catalyst of something like it was here with this man here. He heard, see? Someone was talking. He heard it. He immediately said, this is what I've been looking for. This is what I've been hoping for. Well, actually, what God had answered, his desire. God was giving him the desire of his heart. He recognized it. So he went unto him. Whatever he had heard was sufficient to make him pick up and go and go to see Jesus. Now, see, if you report, like, attendance, that's not going to move anybody to make an honest inquiry into the things of God. It's just not that's not the sort of thing that does it. People said Jesus fed, you know, 5,000 men at one time. But see, that's not the thing that drew these valid people.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, they reported a proper perception of Jesus Christ. He went unto him. He didn't go to investigate the claims. Are you the one? He did. Whatever he heard, he was already on his way to Jesus. He's already convinced he's the one. Remember, Jesus convinced the woman of the well he was the one. People in Samaria, they heard him. They were convinced he's the one. See? And what, all of them was testimony is what amen. Did all of this. Is testimony is what did it.
Yeah, amen.
You say, well, God works on their hearts and opens the heart. But he does it through testimony. He opened Lydia's heart, but it was to the testimony, to the testimony that was given to her. So as we grow in Christ, we learn to talk about the right things. Speak the right things God can use. And you have no idea who they'll quicken or who they'll awaken. And he besought him that he would come down. He besought. I want to look at that word, besought him. Other versions say he implored him, he requested him, he begged him, he made a request, he asked, he pleaded, he prayed, he asked him repeatedly, and he began to beg. Now, I don't like the word ask in this context. Ask is generally asking for an answer. You search scripture and see that this is, but that's not what, this is not what this man is doing here. He's not asking for an answer. Beside that, the word translated besought means request, entreat, beseech, beg. There's a fervency in beseeching that's not in asking. I don't know how you can take asking and blend it with beg, beseech. See, they don't necessarily go together, because the Pharisees asked Jesus some things. So this would be, I would think, would be an improper word here. Yes.
The day that Brother Tom's wife was going to go to the doctor, and she had lost sight in one of her eyes, he was making his way in his truck through the hospital parking lot, and he saw me, and he rushed over there, and he jumped out of the truck, and he besought us to pray for him.
That's right.
I mean, you could tell by his appearance, his whole body was, he wanted someone that was closer to God to ask right then.
Yeah.
And then he got in the truck and he took her, you know, went and got her and took her in. And but see, this was, that kind of was an experience that taught me what besought means.
That's
this is what it means. It's urgent. It's right now. I need this right now.
I know that I receive a lot of requests, hundreds of requests each week for prayer. But most of them are, they're begging more for money. So the most of them, they're not, it's not beseeching. It's not that kind of thing. When you come to God, you want to learn to beseech, plead, entreat. See, those are, bring forth your arguments. That's what God said to Israel.
Yes.
Produce your, tell me why you want me to do this. See? You want health? What are you going to do with your health if you get it?
Amen.
Huh? You want longevity of life? What are you going to do with your life? If I give it to you, what are you going to do with it? See? God thinks this way. And when you think this way, you get the ear.
Amen. Yes.
You get the ear of God. To me, toning down scriptural words is a transgression of first rank. Because it gradually numbs people's conscience. Pretty soon, when they read the scriptures, they make no connection at all between the scriptures and themselves, because these words have been dumbed down, so they don't have this sense of urgency and pleading and presenting your cause and this sort of thing.
Brother Gavin,
yes.
To differ these two words that you're contrasting, this asking and beseeching or besought. There are things that I ask that when I receive an answer, I just receive that information and my question is answered and I'm fine. So it's not really of any consequence. It's just I want to know this for my leisure, so I get the answer and I'm fine. And I'll bring it up again. But then you have the Philippian jailer asking, what must I do to be saved? And when Paul told him, he did it.
That's right.
So this information, Jesus said, ask and you shall receive. So that's not just static information that you get and then you hold in reserve for when you might need to tell somebody else about that information. You've got to act on this.
That's right.
This beseeching
is
something that when you get a response, you're going to act on it.
Yeah. This learning how to present your case to God is a very important thing.
Yeah.
You cannot pray to God just to get things off your chest.
Yeah.
This is, there has to be a sense of urgency about it. Mm-hmm. He's a very present help in the time of need.
Yeah.
See? Now we're told what the case was. My son, it was someone's at the point of death, right up at the doorstep. Now this man had faith. It wasn't as matured yet as it would be. He knew Jesus could heal his son, but thought he had to come to his house to do it. See? He also appears to think that if the son died, it's all over. See, well, both of those are like side of immature faith. It's appointed that a man wants to die. This is the truth. And it appears as though this his son was at that point. See? Now you remember Hezekiah, he was at God told him he was gonna die. Your time had come, and Hezekiah put his face to the wall, and he begged.
Yeah.
God said, all right, I'll give you 15 more years. How's that?
Yeah.
Huh? He extended him past the point. Mm-hmm. Says God do that? Well, there's a case I think he did, yes.
Yeah.
I think that Paul, he thought several times, he thought he was on the verge of death. God pushed him past that because he had something for him to do.
Yeah, we may have witnessed God doing that same thing for you, Brother Gibbon.
I've thought about it, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's been more than once I thought that here I come, Lord, you know.
When you began the Genesis series.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I've asked the Lord to give me time to finish the work he's given me to do, and I don't think I'm finished yet, but reserve the right to be wrong.
Mm-hmm. We ask that too of the Lord.
Valid pleadings with the Lord are always subject to God's will. Now it's important.
Yes.
It's important to remember that.
Amen.
John taught on this. This is a matter of teaching. This is the confidence we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He heareth us.
Mm-hmm.
And if we know that He hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that he desired of him. Now, if you wonder whether that's true, then you just look at this case. He heard this petition, and he did it.
Yeah. Amen.
He heard the Syrophoenician woman. He healed her daughter, right?
Mm-hmm.
He heard Jairus' plea, and his daughter was raised from the dead.
Right.
See, if he hears, you've got examples of this now.
Amen.
All through the gospel, you've got examples of him hearing and doing.
Yes.
And the proviso is, if we ask anything according to his will, that is why you have to grow up into Christ in all things. Because the will of God is not known at the kindergarten level.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It's all you can do to keep out of the mud down here.
Mm-hmm.
Tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. See, that's the result of not growing up. When you grow up into him, then you're able to detect his will and to shape your prayers in view of that will.
Yeah.
And you've got a promise. If you pray, if you ask anything according to his will, he'll hear you.
Yeah.
Amen.
And if he hears you, he'll do it.
Yeah. Amen.
That's a wonderful
yeah.
That's a wonderful promise. That's just not a piece of information to store away.
Yeah.
This is something you incorporate into your life. You say, God, I want to pray in accordance with your will because you've made a commitment on this.
Amen.
Yeah.
And I believe you're able to do what you promised.
Walking in faith is aligning yourself with God's will anyway.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's
but it has,
the core of it.
Yeah, it has to be seen. See, it
mm-hmm.
has to be seen. Faith now comes from God. The grace of God was exceeding abundant with faith and love. Ephesians 6:23, and Jesus is the author
yes.
and the finisher of faith.
Mm-hmm.
And faith is substantive and evidential, right? It shapes the way those who have it think. If God tells Abraham, offer Isaac up on an altar as a burnt offering, Abraham's faith says, I'm going to do this, and God will no doubt raise him from the dead.
Amen.
Then when he was 99, he was in his mid-80s before God told him that the seed he promised was going to personally beget the seed. So he's about 85 before he knew it was going to be him that began it. And he was 99 before he knew that Sarah was going to bear it. When all these things gelled in his mind, he said he was fully persuaded. He didn't consider the deadness of Sarah's womb or his own. He being impotent. He didn't consider these things. He was strong in faith, giving glory to God, being fully persuaded that what God had promised is able to do.
Yes.
See? Your faith as it matures, it will lead you to the same conclusion.
Amen.
Tonight you may not be able to think this way yet. Mm-hmm. But if you grow up into Christ in all things, you give attendance to keeping the faith and living by faith, you'll come to this same kind of conclusion, that what God has promised, he is able to perform.
Amen.
Even if he's got an impotent man and a dead womb to do it with. I thank God for that.
Amen.
Because faith comes from God and is factual evidence, then you can pray in faith. Nothing doubting.
That's right. Yes.
As James said. Yeah. However, faith is always tested. So that now we deal with what Jesus responds. Now here he comes, he pleads, begs Jesus to come and heal his son, who's at the point of death. Now sometimes Jesus said, I will come. One man asked him that. He said, I will come. Okay. That's not what Jesus says now.
Yeah.
I hear what Jesus says to this request. He said, except ye see signs and wonders, ye will not believe. All right, that's a test now.
Yeah.
Going to test the nobleman. Not because Jesus doesn't know. Because he knew what was in man. The scriptures tell us that. He didn't need to know this. This is to confirm to the nobleman the strength of his faith. He will cause the nobleman to reach deeper, to reach higher, to stretch his soul, so that he's thinking more of Jesus than of his sick son.
Amen.
It's a major triumph when you can think of God more than of the problem. You've made some real progress.
Yes, amen.
That's what God wants for you. Jesus is glorified, see, when men pursue their petitions in the strength of faith. Now, this was probably said publicly because his disciples went with him from Samaria into Galilee. So I'm assuming there was people around there. In fact, he's saying this to the people. Some versions read that way. And he said it to the people. You people must see proof, see? If people don't see miracles. The New King James Version says, unless you people see signs and wonders. He's speaking to the body of people that included the nobleman, but wasn't confined to him, except you see signs and wonders. Other versions say, unless you people see signs and wonders, if you people don't see miracles and amazing things, unless I do more and more miracles, you people must see proofs from God and miracles, unless you see signs and miracles happen. Is Jesus sensitive about this kind of thing? Yes, he is.
Amen.
If you do this, I'll do that. Some people pray this way. Look, if you do this, I'll do that. Oh? Oh? He's speaking to everyone present. Is the nobleman really different? See? Jesus is going to bring out that he is different. Is he different than anyone else? Or has he been swallowed up with the doubters? They swallowed him up. See? We're living in a powerless religious world. Are we separate from it? It's not enough just to say we are. Are we? Jesus will test us to see.
Amen.
if we're really in that class or not. He'll prove his faith. See, Jesus won't allow people of faith to remain unidentified. Mm-hmm. He'll bring out who they are. Because this brings glory to God, you see. It brings glory. When Jesus told about the good shepherd that lost one of his sheep out of his fold, it kind of changes the way you view that parable, but that's what he said. And when he brought that lamb home on his shoulder, everybody knew what was going on. In history, Job excelled his peers. There was a man in the land of Uz. One. He excelled his peers. But the circumstances he went through proved he did.
Yeah, that's right.
Right? It proved he did. Mm-hmm. Joseph's faith was greater than the faith of his brothers. They didn't know this, but his stint in Egypt proved it was. See? Abraham's faith excelled those of his age. But this test to offer up Isaac proved it was. See, those who desire a trouble-free life, they got to think higher. Having a trouble-free life isn't the thing that distinguishes us. Having a lot of riches isn't what distinguishes us. Being debt-free, that's not what... I mean, we want these experiences, I understand. But that's not what distinguishes us. There's some really ungodly people that are debt-free. So this is not what distinguishes us. So tests, God's tests, are designed to reveal what distinguishes his people from the masses. If I except I see you, I do signs and wonders, you will not believe. Well, what a statement. Mm-hmm. You will not believe. You will by no means believe. New American Standard says you simply will not believe. Mm-hmm. You'll never believe. American Standard Version. You will not have faith. Basic Bible. You simply will not trust. Holman Bible. They won't believe. God's Word Bible. Won't any of you believe me? Living Bible. Or you will never believe. International English Bible. Or the Amplified Bible. You people never will believe. Trust, have faith at all. So faith does not come by seeing the miraculous.
Yeah, amen.
You can take a whole body of people and walk them through the Red Sea on dry land.
Yeah.
Drown all their enemies before their eyes, and before they've gone very far at all, they'll begin to gripe.
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. See, seeing miraculous things does not induce faith.
Amen.
The soldiers saw an angel. Were there when Jesus rose from the dead, apparently. Mm-hmm. And they took a payoff to be quiet.
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
If this was not Jesus speaking, if Jesus hadn't said this, you might be prone to question what he said. Because a lot of people followed him, and a lot of people did believe because of miracles. The scriptures tell us this. But these people that believed, that saw his miracles and believed, and there are several instances I give you here where they did. These were the exceptions. These weren't the rules. Now, Paul alluded to this propensity of the Jews to want a miracle. Here's what he said to the Corinthians, who the Gentiles. For the Jews require a sign. See, that was a kind of a national trait. Yeah. Of course, there had been a lot of signs given to that nation. In fact, that's the only nation there were a lot of signs given to. I don't know if you want to count them up, but I think it's a really high count. So the Jews, they wanted that to keep on. Yeah. But it didn't. Remember when Jesus was here, the Jews said to him, "What sign showest thou unto us, seeing that thou doest these things?" He was working miracles.
Yeah.
And he said, "Show us a sign so we can confirm that you're really the Christ." And certain of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, "Master, we would see a sign from thee." See, this was a propensity of this group of people. Luke writes, "And others tempting him sought of him a sign from heaven." Rather than being honest inquirers, these sayings were their attempt to stay where they were. It was their attempt to stay where they were. I don't think anyone here actually does this or has done it, but you don't want to try and strike a bargain with God. "Oh God, if there is a God," you know, I've heard people say this. Well, that kind of prayer just bounces back down to earth, because it said, "He that cometh to him must believe that he is." See? So that's, you know, that doesn't even get off the ground. The heavens just become brass and it comes back down. But a lot of those kind of prayers are prayed in our time and encouraged. Now, in our day, the chief means of impressing men in truth is the gospel. Is anybody going to win anybody to Christ who doesn't speak the gospel? The gospel is the power, not a power, is the power of God unto salvation. There it is. It's all embodied in a message, not in a miracle, in a message. In a message. That's where it's embodied, in a message. Not in a method, not in a deed of kindness, not in cleaning up someone's yard.
That's right.
We're not against those things. You understand, we're not against those things. Anyone who does good, we're for it. We're saying that nobody's going to believe on Christ because those things are done.
That's right.
Yeah. Believing on Christ is a direct, exclusive response to the gospel of Christ.
Amen.
It's that way because God uses the gospel to dispense faith.
Amen.
Jesus is the author and the finisher of faith. And it is authored through the gospel. So the miracles were not the means of obtaining faith. You remember that Philip went down to Samaria and he preached Christ unto them. And then he did a lot of miracles. He wasn't an apostle either, but he did a lot of miracles down there. And it's written, he said that we went and preached Christ to them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. Now the miracles were seen in the context of what he said.
Amen.
They didn't give heed to the miracles. You gotta see the text. They didn't give heed to the miracles. They gave heed to what Philip said. See, it's a technical point, but that is the point. I'm thankful it's that way because preaching is not always attended by miracles. John, he did no miracle, and he preached the gospel. He did no miracle, so there's a. Most of us have preached the gospel without it being attended by miracles. Now, if God worked on, we're not going to turn it down. You understand? But that's not why people believe. People believe because of the gospel.
Amen.
The gospel is preached. If the gospel is not believed, no sign or wonder can induce faith in the people.
That's right.
And the ministry of John the Baptist is a stirring example. He did no miracle, yet there were many that believed. Now, if this is true, there's no church program, or provision or entertainment or methodology that can bring people to Jesus.
That's right.
This isn't how God works. Mm-hmm. He doesn't work through a concert. This isn't how he works.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
We're not against concerts. We go to them ourselves. We go to them ourselves. We're not against concerts, but that's not how you bring people to Jesus.
Uh-huh.
This is not how it's done.
Amen.
This isn't how this isn't why the nobleman came to Jesus. It wasn't because he had an entertainment program was
right.
put on. He came
yeah.
because he heard what Jesus was saying and
yes.
doing.
Amen.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, remember we used to go to South Bend.
Yeah.
And they would have a concert, they would sing songs, but they always had somebody stand up and say something,
that's
preach
right.
something.
Well, yeah.
Because they knew this was true.
Yeah.
Back then. Now, you know, it wasn't like a comedy. It was they preached Christ
yeah,
in between the songs. And but this is why they did it. It wasn't just like a method. They saw this is the only way people are going
yeah,
to be come
right.
to Christ.
See, then this opens you, if you preach the gospel, this opens the avenue for whatever God wants to do, whatever, if he wants to work a flood of miracles, we'll accept it.
Yeah.
We're not certainly not opposed to something like that, and we're not tell people God quit doing that.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's in this context of the gospel. It may be that the reason why miracles kind of begin to trail off is because the gospel began to cease to be preached.
Yeah.
You can trace it back to that too. Well, you can see that what a response that was. You come to
yeah,
Jesus.
Yeah.
You come to Jesus and say, come down, heal my son. Well, except you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. Didn't, we'll find it didn't dampen the spirits of this nobleman at all.
Yeah.
Sir, come down.
Yeah.
He pressed in, see.
Uh-huh.
He intuitively, he knew something about Jesus.
Uh-huh.
He knew Jesus is not going to, like, abandon somebody that's making a request of him.
Yeah.
Fervent request. Well, those are some things to consider. Any of you have something you'd like to add tonight?
That was very good.
Well, I'll put it this way. I got a lot out of it.
Yes.
Yeah. You'll find everything we go with, it all blends together.
Yes.
As we plot through all these different uh-huh. circumstances and all these different events and so
yeah.
forth, they all blend together. Jesus never did anything that was unblendable.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
somebody could think, well, that sounds kind of negative, Jesus. I mean, he came and he asked you to do something. And look, you just kind of like brushed him off there, but you're right. The man pressed in. He didn't let that stop him.
That's right.
He was coming. He really did have a need.
That's right.
The need outweighed whatever. You know, like when he told the woman that they eat from the crumbs, and she said,
truth.
To the dog. She said, truth, Lord.
Truth.
It was the truth, but she wasn't going anywhere.
That's right. Truth, Lord, but let's not forget those crumbs.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, Brother Judah.
You made the point before. I think it's in the Luke studies where Jesus has a string of consecutive parables, and it sounds like he's just jumping from topic to topic without warning and without context, because it's in a parable that people aren't understanding what he's saying. I kind of sense that there was that kind of atmosphere here, because he spoke to the people. So the nobleman says, come and heal my son, which was a request for a miracle, but he says, except you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. Well, the man wasn't asking to believe. He said, come down and do this for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you can see to the perceptive mind, let me say it this way, to the mind of the flesh, Jesus' responses can seem off the wall.
Yeah.
Have nothing to do with what's going on, nothing to do with the request that's been presented. But to the perceptive mind that Jesus gives understanding to, you can see that he's not speaking just to hear himself talk.
Yeah.
Jesus' words are very pointed.
Yeah.
And that includes this here.
One time Jesus said to Moses, speak to me no more of this matter.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Pled for Israel.
Yeah, that's right.
Don't speak anymore to me about this.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Of what Brother Judah was saying, I remember when I was reading John 9, when it was when he healed the blind man. At the beginning of the chapter, it says he was saying that I am the light of, the Son of Man is the light of the world, and I can't exactly quote it right off of my head, but I am the light of the world, and I work in the light before it is dark. And I remember reading that, and I'm like, how has that got anything to do with the miracle that he's about to perform? Why, how's that got anything to do? Yeah. And so, but then when I was as I was studying it, I'm like, he was introducing exactly what he was going to do to the blind man and to the Pharisees. So.
Yeah. Amen. Yes, Aaliyah.
And when you're talking about Jesus did his miracles for them to be remembered, I was thinking he didn't do it to for his name to be glorified. He did that so his Father's name would be glorified.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
That's
yeah.
right.
Amen.
I think, yes. Yes, all right.
You know, I think it's interesting that Jesus, he's calling people to believe in him, you know, not just to be look for miracles. He's calling people to, hey, put your faith in me and follow me for who
That's
I am.
Right.
And, I think that people heard that rebuke, you know what I mean? There are people around him, and maybe even the person who was asking for help anyway. You know, he's asking for help for his person, but he's sitting there. Jesus is calling him for more, you know, and I think he took that challenge and said, you know, if he does this for me, maybe I do need to put my life in his hands, you know? And later on, you find out he does. So we can choose to listen to God's rebukes sometimes and change. Now is the time to change and to stand on that. And when we see people who are seemingly getting overly fond of miracles, to try to point them the right direction with the Lord.
Yes, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Something else you can see is he made this special mention. He came again to Cana of Galilee, and that's where he made the water wine. So you can see he came back to that spot, that place where he'd already worked a miracle, but now he's going to do something different. Jesus is not one-sided. He can make you walk on the water if need be. He can make you fly over the water. Viewing the water as time of trouble or a time of trial, he can part the waters for you and make your way easy, or he can make you swim through it, or he can make you walk on or fly over. But think about the various positions that God's people have been saved from. That's Jesus. It's not Jesus and someone else saved this person from that, or Jesus and someone else saved another person from something else. It's all Jesus. He's bringing many sons to glory. And he does it in different ways, yes, but who are we to question the way Jesus does things? Mm-hmm. He can do it.
You know, it was different than when we turned water into wine. It was private.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Only a handful of people even knew what he did. Yeah. Yes. Eva.
You said the thing that identifies you is what God thinks of you.
That's right.
It is a thing that, to some people, it can cause great fear. To some, at times, it can be very sobering. To some, it can be a thing that causes great joy. Something that I immediately thought of was the rich man and Lazarus. Is that the thing that defined them was what God thought of them, or even the thief on the cross, the two thieves on the crosses. The one that said, Lord, remember me when you enter into paradise. The thing that defined them in the end was what God thought of them. And it's a very good thing to keep in mind that there are things that can distract us from what God thinks of us, but in the end that's really,
yes,
really what matters.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
All right. We're ready for...